I was taught that one should do higher repetition movements with lighter weights in order to warm up. And then one of the things that did make a big positive difference for me in terms of strength and hypertrophy training was to do a moderate repetition warm-up with a fairly light weight, but then to actually keep the number of warm-up repetitions fairly low and work progressively toward the first so-called work set. When you say 3 to 5, that's 3 to 5 work sets, correct?
Yep.
Are you also gonna tell me 3 to 5 warm-ups?
No.
Are you also gonna tell me it has to be done between 3 and 5 PM? So in terms of—
With three to five friends?
In all seriousness, what does a good warm-up look like?
Yeah.
And I realize this will vary depending on how cool your training environment is, time of day, et cetera. But as a kind of umbrella for a good warm-up,
okay,
what should people do?
You've already sort of jumped the gun with my answer. It is honestly very dependent upon the person. So some folks respond very well to a minimum warm up. Others, I've had lots of actually professional fighters I've worked with, where I actually have a Major League Baseball player right now. He's one of the best pitchers in the game, probably the best. And the longer we warm up, the better his numbers get. We actually did a vertical jump test with him. He's gonna kill me because he got so mad. I wanted to see how long it sort of took him to reach a peak vertical jump. And most times this takes people something like 5 to 10 sort of reps. And I said, take it up all the way to a maximum vertical jump. And then what I want you to do is continue to jumping until you have 3 consecutive jumps where you're down lower than 90%. And so what we were trying to look at is sort of when is he going to break? Because in baseball, he's going to throw like 100 pitches or so. And we're trying to figure out when is his peak velocity on his fastball going to drop and sort of base his conditioning on that. So it's a different style of conditioning. It's power endurance is really what it is. He called me in the middle of it. I'm like, oh, you're done, whatever. And he's just like, no, like, how many of these am I supposed to do? And I was like, what are you talking about? He's like, I'm on rep 130 or something. And I was like, what? And I'm like, what rep did you peak on? He peaked on rep 70, something like that. 69, I think, technically, because he's goofy. So he's a classic example. I've worked with him for many, many years. We have a ton of data on him, a ton of biological data, a ton of neuromuscular stuff, like all kinds of stuff. And it just, the more he warms up, an absurd amount of warm-up, the better he gets. And the better he gets in power production, and the better he gets in speed and velocity. So his warm-up prior to games is, it's totally absurd. And just the more volume we throw at him, the better he does. I have other folks, you get past like 2 or 3 reps and fatigue starts to set in. And now you're actually like reducing power production. So there is a ton of variation that goes in that. I can give you some guidelines though. You need to differentiate if you're training for speed, power, strength, or hypertrophy. Here's why. If we understand a little bit about what's causing the adaptation, that's going to tell you what you need to do or avoid. For example, volume is the primary driver in hypertrophy. Intensity is the primary driver in speed, power, and strength. All right. So what that means is you need to preserve intensity for the first three. You need to preserve volume in the second one at most. So if your warm-up is so extensive in the hypertrophy training, that it compromises your training volume because of fatigue, even if it compromises the last set of the last exercise, then you're actually probably walking yourself backwards by doing that extensive. You would have been better off starting your first working set slightly suboptimal, right? Because it's not really, you're just trying to accrue volume at that point. Strength and power is the opposite. Until you're moving very, very fast or powerfully, you're not really causing the adaptation. So there's no point in starting your working set until you're really basically at 100%. So the warm-up should be as long as it takes you to get to where your mobility is in the right spot, like your joints feel good, you feel fresh, you feel activated, and you really feel peak power. Anything before that is a warm-up set. In the sport of Olympic weightlifting, a lot of times the coaches will measure barbell velocity. Travis Mash has done a fantastic job with this. He's got a lot of data on what's called velocity-based training. Brian Mann at Missouri and Miami, tons of work here. And generally those communities are not going to count any repetition as a working set until you exceed 70% of your one rep max. Where that's changed because of a lot of people doing the velocity-based stuff is now they're basing that simply on an achieved velocity. And so really the warm-up is irrelevant. They don't even, it's sort of just like do whatever you want and we're gonna measure the barbell until you actually hit an outcome. And now you're at a working set. So different ways to think about it, depending on what you're training for, that'll give you a little bit of a guideline. If you're training for anything past hypertrophy, then really, and especially even hypertrophy, it just comes down to, are you feeling ready to work? Are you cold? Are you moving through the correct positions? And if all those things are fine, I don't care if you start a little bit early and save some gas at the end of it, especially if you're a person like you who may be a bit more inclined to fatigue quickly relative to Trevor, who's just has no response to fatigue whatsoever.
Is it useful to do more warm up at the beginning of a workout, say before the first exercise, and then once one has achieved both local and systemic warm up, in air quotes, then perhaps on the second or third exercise, fourth exercise, et cetera, one or maybe even zero warm ups?
Yeah, fair point. We generally think about warm ups in a couple of ways. This is a very clever question. You want to have some sort of general global warm-up scheme. We tend to prefer dynamic warm-ups. So this is whole body movements rather than like sitting and stretching, static stretching, things like that.
So something that involves momentum.
Yeah, momentum or movement, right? So this is like, think about this in like old gym class. It's like your high knees and your butt kickers and just different things like that where you're moving in different planes. You're moving joints through tons of range of motion. You're getting a lot of movement there. So you're getting the local warm-up. You're also getting the total systemic activation. Everything else is going on there. So that is what we consider to be a general warm-up. 5 minutes is a very sufficient number. Perhaps 10 if you're a slow goer, achy, and some things like that. And you really got to get the ankle warmed up if you're doing lower body stuff. Really make sure that that's moving correctly. The hips and knees will follow. Upper body stuff, really get the shoulder blades and the neck, like making sure you're going there, and the elbows will follow after that. So 5 to 7 minutes of a general warm-up. A lot of the times, like classic exercise science, it will even just put you on a bike, cycling for 5 minutes. I don't like that personally. Dynamic movement is more preferred. If you really just move for 5 to 7 minutes, you'll be fine there. Now, specificity within each movement. It's very important that your first exercise of the day is generally the thing you prioritize. That's oftentimes the most important you're going to do. It oftentimes is also the most complex and the most moving parts. So it tends to be multi-joint. Therefore, you need to have movement, precision, and skill dialed, right? You don't typically start your workouts off with the forearm curl, right? Like that's, you don't need a tremendous amount of warm-up to get going on that. You're going to start off with medicine ball throws or a snatch or some agility work. You need to have the whole system going because multiple joints are moving, position matters, technique. There's just a lot of skill requirement, et cetera. So the individualized workout or the specific workout for the specific movement, for that very first one, my general rule of thumb is like whatever it takes to move perfect in that first exercise. Past that, you don't necessarily need to do individualized warm-ups for your next movements unless it is a movement you're trying to learn or just even get a little bit better at. Like drop the load a little bit, work on some, accruing some practice reps. Fantastic. Or it's another dissimilar complex movement. So let's say your first exercise was a front squat and you got loaded for that. And now you're going to move into a pull-up, but your mechanics aren't the best there. And so you really need to change and do some maybe more specific activation or warm-ups for that or something else. Or it's running or something totally different. So yeah, you don't need to re-warm up for every single exercise as you go. Generally, once you're good to go, the same muscles that you're going to use in the next exercise are warm, same joints, then you're good to go.